Hello and welcome to Reality Check. Why ISIS appears to be casting a deeper shadow across South India, extending even as far as Sri Lanka. This on a day when the National Investigating Agency conducted searches at 7 locations in Coimbatore and Tamil Nadu as part of their investigation into ISIS modules in that city. A day ago, the NIA had booked 6 men in Coimbatore of ISIS links, all between the age of 26 to 38, accusing one of them, Muhammad Azharuddin, of links to Zehran Hashim, one of the men behind Sri Lanka's Easter Day bombing. The NIA claimed that Azharuddin was the leader of the Coimbatore module, that he's been maintaining a Facebook page called Khilafa GFX, through which he had been propagating ISIS ideology. All 6, the NIA claimed, were doing this to recruit youth for carrying out terror attacks in South India, especially in Kerala and Tamil Nadu. The police claim to have found phones, SIMs, laptops, airgun pellets and so on. Now, the latest round of arrests builds on 2 main ISIS-linked cases in South India being probed by the NIA. The first is from Kasaragod in Kerala of 2016, where a group of over 20 men and women, some with families, left for ISIS-controlled territories in Afghanistan and Syria. The second is from last year, where the NIA accused 7 persons from across Tamil Nadu for pledging allegiance to ISIS and conspiring to kill Hindu leaders in Coimbatore. It's in the course of investigation of these 2 cases that Indian agencies claim they managed to glean intelligence about possible attacks in Sri Lanka, which they passed on to Lanka. Now, let's look at this a little more closely tonight on the show. And to do that, I have with me A.S. Dulat, of course, former RAW chief, one of our most distinguished voices on national security. Sekhar Datta, he's covered the NATSEC beat for a very long time indeed. And I'm also joined from Bangalore by Mohammad Saqib, who's the Karnataka state president of PFI, the Popular Front of India, which is the Kerala-based Muslim group that often has found itself in the crosshairs of investigating agencies. Let me just start with you, Sekhar, and what you make of this. Now, you know, since the Lanka bombings, we've seen a spate of raids by the NIA trying to trace, in a sense, the Indian link to the radical outfits that came to the light in Sri Lanka. But this has been going on now for some time, even before the Lanka bombings, this focus on the shadow of ISIS over South India. What do you make of it? Do you think that there is something that's going on, particularly with the South, which is making it more of a fertile ground for recruitment and for radicalization than perhaps other parts of India?
Let me just start with a little bit of what we know from these investigations after what happened in Sri Lanka.
Sure.
To start with, what you mentioned about the module which went in 2016 from Kasaragod, and there were intelligence reports that some of them had gone to Nangarhar province in Afghanistan.
Yes.
And some of them even went to Syria and then came back to what is known as the Islamic State Khorasan province module, which
right.
has in some ways been the key module which has been working on South Asia, the Khorasan province module. And it was initially started by a man who worked very closely with the ISI in Pakistan, and he was sent to take over this, and there were some linkages even with the Lashkar-e-Toyba, etc. Last year, after a lot of work between Indian intelligence and Afghan intelligence, they started bringing back some of them back to India, and one of them during his interrogation told the Indian investigators about this module in Coimbatore, and when they found the module sometime in, I think, September or so, these people started talking about relationship with a module in Sri Lanka, and that's how these alerts started coming out. So that's
right.
the story that we know about, the role of the Islamic state Khorasan province and what subsequently has become a separate Islamic state, especially for South Asia. Now, why South India? Coming specifically to that, I've been reading a lot of interrogation reports nearly of all the people who were arrested and a lot of them who were not arrested as a deliberate policy of the government of India, because they didn't want to push these youngsters into jails and then, you know, further radicalize them.
Yes.
And if you start looking at, looking for patterns, if when you read so many interrogation reports.
Yes.
In some ways, you know, the fact that many of them are very well educated.
Yes.
And at some level, they're also feeling extremely alienated within the community. And there is also a radicalization or a reaction within the larger majoritarian communities in South Asia. This has started making them, and that's the feeling you start getting, asking about their identity and their role and their faith.
Okay.
And because of social media, many of them were starting to communicate. And this communication in social media and the questions that they were raising, which very clearly comes out in these interrogation reports, is what led them to start exploring ways which we loosely call as radicalization.
Right. You know, Dulat Saab, I wonder what you make of this, because, you know, firstly, just to put it in perspective, overall, when we talk about ISIS, either recruitment or people in India who are traveling to ISIS-controlled territories, it's still a very small fraction compared to other parts of the world, and also compared to the size of the Muslim population here. I believe the numbers that the agencies put out are currently at about 140 to 150 individuals, which is overall in perspective a very small number. But the fact is that when you consider the overall map of communal, if you want to put it, tensions in India, you generally associate that much more with the north. That's where you really see much more communal friction. But at the same time, you do tend to find that there does appear to be a greater amount of whatever the word one wants to use, radicalization or the shadow of a group like the ISIS in the south. How do you read that?
Well, I'm first of all, let me say that Saikat knows far too much for me. But he has hinted at something. He has hinted
Not more than usual.
This happens, why this radicalization, why what provokes all this.
Yes.
I think that is important to understand. And I'm not surprised that if boys from India do go to Syria or to Afghanistan, they would be from South India, more specifically from Kerala, where we have large Muslim pockets.
So, and also the connection to the Gulf. So,
but at the also connected to the Gulf and to Saudi Arabia, because let me say this, and I would say this not only of India but Pakistan as well.
Yes.
Notwithstanding the module that Saikat has talked about, that our if there is a leaning towards ISIS or Daesh.
Yes.
It would be minimal, and our Islam is a very moderate Islam, Indian Islam in particular.
Yes, it is.
You know, Islam came mostly from Persia.
I agree with you.
You know, actually, Pakistan was the same till 1971.
Yes.
Till the war in 71 and the creation of Bangladesh, when Bhutto started looking west. And that has had an impact in Pakistan. But I think even there, Pakistan understands that I think India is more important for it than
no,
possibly
I agree
their
with
friends
you that
in Saudi Arabia.
I agree that the foot, you know, that the overall, it's a,
and
it is,
know,
as you said, a much
whatever
more...
It is
a much more... Yes, it is overall a much more a moderate strain of Islam, but certainly... there are these exceptions,
let
but I just want to bring in.
Add,
I just want to bring in. I'll come back to you. So I just want to bring in.
Let me also add.
Swaranjit Sen, I'll just come back
Vasu,
to you.
Let me just add one point. Okay.
I'll just come back to you in a second. Swaranjit Sen, just wanted to ask
you
that one of the reasons why that we are seeing higher numbers in the south, could it also be because there is a much greater architecture of security of intelligence in the south? There's much better monitoring. you are joining us from Hyderabad, and you've been former DGP Andhra Pradesh. And the Telangana police, for example, we know does a fantastic job of monitoring this kind of extremist online activity. And they run one of the best de-radicalization programs in India. And so could that also be one of the reasons why you get bigger numbers from the south than, say, from the north?
Well, what you're in fact saying is that the intelligence system in the south is more geared up towards locating such agencies and agents.
Perhaps.
I would say that is probably absolutely right. They have been focusing for a long time. Yeah, perhaps they have been focusing for a long time. And what I would like to say is that we have to remember that things have changed now. Earlier we were saying about, you know, I used to object when anyone said these are homegrown terrorists. But today I would agree that they are homegrown. Persons who are above the age of 30, you cannot say that they are just youth.
Right.
They are people who have been indoctrinated, and now they themselves are trying to indoctrinate the youth.
Right.
So it's a very, very disturbing trend.
Right.
And I feel this trend is going to increase unless we clamp down mercilessly. Mercilessly. Otherwise, there is no chance. Now,
okay.
Basically, South is a peaceful area.
Yes.
Right? The polarization between Muslims and other communities, I would say, is absent.
Yes.
Now, using this kind of a situation, the these people, the terrorists and their organizations, are taking advantage of the good people.
Right.
And this trend is going to increase in the South. We have to also realize that they're going to find new places to exploit. And so we are in for quite a challenge.
Okay. Well, that's quite a that's quite a worrying forecast.
That I would, really like to see.
I hope that doesn't happen. But if I can just now bring in Mohammad Saqib, who's, as we said, Karnataka State President of the PFI. Mohammad Saqib, how would you explain this phenomenon, particularly because you must have seen this, that on several instances, the police, the investigating agencies, have also drawn in the PFI into their ambit of investigations when they're going after groups that have, individuals that have extremist links.
Srini, there are two aspects to this debate or discussion that we are having now.
Yes.
One, as you have rightly said, that the contribution of Indian Muslims or Muslim youths or terrorists to this greater terrorist or evil elements called the ISIS is very negligible.
Right.
Hardly 100 all over India.
Right.
That you have said in your discussion. And you have also said that there are various reasons for these terrorist elements for not growing their ground or not making India as their breeding ground in India. Out of the many reasons which our panelists have said, there is one more important reason which cannot be negated.
Okay.
That is Popular Front of India.
Okay.
Popular Front of India's Islamic education, our interpretation of Islam and our interpretation of the Quranic verses, which is going to the grassroots, which goes till the Muslim youths who get radicalized by Sangh Parivar many other times. We interpret the Quranic ayat, we educate them in such a way that you should not involve in terrorist activities. You
Once
should
again,
involve
you're saying
in democratic
PFI's,
struggle. You should
you're
involve
saying,
in judicial
You're
struggle.
Saying PFI is actually fighting radicalization.
We are educating the youth to not to... Yeah, we are fighting. We are a neutralizer. We are a neutralizing effect in India, which cannot be negated, which also the NIA knows.
Okay,
which
but
also
then,
the NIA knows.
But then
in
why?
In many times, these terrorists, these notorious... Let me complete my point. See,
yes.
Let me complete my point.
Yes.
These notorious terrorist groups, many other times they have said, we will have to kill Popular Front leaders. These mentors are the dangerous people who are against our interpretation of Quran, our interpretation of Islam.
No,
this,
but just a second. Before
they
that, have, before
they
that...
This, not only this IS
okay,
terrorist,
okay.
There are many
but
terrorists.
Let me, no, but now I have to jump in. You say this... Yes. And
so
yet,
the point what I am trying to
just
make
a second,
is we
just
are a
second.
Neutralizer in India.
No, no, hold on, hold on. We have to have shorter answers. This is a debate, not a monologue. But, you know, you say this on one hand. On the other hand, we did some research and this is, you know, just based on cursory research. But tell me if I'm right or wrong here, that in June 2019, PFI pamphlets were found at the houses of those the NIA had raided in Coimbatore. In May 2019, 8 PFI officers were raided in connection with the Sri Lanka blast. In October 2017, 3 of your activists were arrested from Kannur for ISIS links. In August 2017, a PFI SDPI, this is your political wing activist, left to join ISIS and was killed in Afghanistan. How do you reconcile this with your contention that you're actually fighting ISIS?
I will tell you. Let me put this into perspective. These fellows are not satisfied with Popular Front's belief.
Okay.
They are not happy with the angle of Popular Front of India's working style.
Okay.
They reject our ideology.
You're saying
believe
these
in
are not your members.
Ideology. They don't want to be part of the mainstream.
No, no. You're
see,
saying these men are
see,
not your members?
We have more than 2.5 lakh members in...
No, these men you're saying see, are not your members?
I am telling very clearly, they may be part of the organization or they would have come to our programs in some part of time.
Yes.
But they reject our ideology. They reject the organization. Many
but
times
you,
they say
but did you expel
that
Popular
Front of India is the dangerous organization, yeah, which is not allowing us to grow.
No, no, but hold on. Did you,
yeah?
Did you, Mohammed Saqib, did the PFI expel them? Did you kick them out?
Yeah. We kicked them out and we want the intelligence agencies to take them to task. They will destroy the Muslim community of India. They will destroy the whole nation. That is what is our stand. This is the education that we are giving. This is
this is
our literature.
Okay,
and
but
they
at
reject
the same
our
time,
literature.
Okay, but at the same time, the fact is that, you know, many of your members were, booked or charged. Your offices were raided. Anyway, you insist that you're actually fighting terrorism. Lalitha Kumaramangalam joins us from the BJP. Lalitha Kumaramangalam, you know, this worrying aspect of the fact that of whatever small instances of ISIS activity we see, the fact that it's more in the south, what do you make of it? Because as we've all been talking about, the south is less polarized than the north, you see less communal tension, and yet there's a growing instance. One of the reasons that Saikat pointed out, Saikat Datta, was that this is also a reaction to the fact that even within the majority community, there is a hardening, there is a radicalization, and this is a reaction to that. Would you agree? Lalitha Kumaramangalam, can you hear me? Okay. We seem to have an issue with her line. We'll just get her up in just a second, but let me quickly take that to Saikat. Saikat, do you want to expand a little bit on the fact that there is also perhaps a reaction to the fact that we are seeing a greater, a sort of a rise in majoritarianism? Could that be linked? Because in some cases, some would argue that these people are just getting radicalized on the internet.
So let me just say that whatever I'm telling you is based on the interrogation reports that I've accessed.
Saqib, we'll come back to you in a second. Go ahead, Saqib.
So if you look at the interrogation reports and if you read them and if you try to establish a pattern from what is coming out, because the interrogation reports has a wide cross-section of people from different economic strata,
right,
and different sociological backgrounds. For example, if you read the interrogation reports of the first boys from Maharashtra who decided to go, they weren't very well off, but they were fairly decent. And yet there was a certain amount of appeal for this kind of ideology.
Hmm.
But there was a distinct difference from those who had embraced terrorism earlier and this breed. And here is the difference. For example, if you look at whatever terrorism that we have faced in India,
yeah,
there was never a global connect to any of the global jihadi causes, etc. And no Indian Muslim ever signed up.
Right.
And in fact, the RNAW, the Research and Analysis Wing, of which Mr. Dullah headed, they did a study and they found that only one person from Hyderabad had actually signed up.
Right.
He went to Pakistan, was not very happy, tried to go to the Middle East.
Okay.
And
so
then he came back and he was so upset and he was so depressed, he committed suicide.
Right.
So there has never been a greater appeal till the ISIS came along.
Okay.
And the difference here is that now the ISIS, in some ways, it's a minuscule number.
Yeah.
But they feel that, you know, their identity is under some kind of threat, and this is the fear that is exploited by these handlers,
okay,
from
Lalitha,
Syria or other places where the ISIS grew.
Right. Saikat, Lalitha Kumaramangalam, let me try to go back to you now, and if you can hear me, that my question to you really was that this concern about the growing influence of ISIS in the south, minuscule as it may seem, could one of the reasons also be that this is a reaction to a perception amongst the minority community that there is a growing majority fundamentalism as well?
Vasu, let's not forget that the first loss in the South in Coimbatore in 1993, which is quite a long way, I mean, it's been a long time since then, about 16 years. And there were a lot of people who were put behind bars, there were organizations that were banned, etc. But now it seems to be taking a new shape, the inroads the ISIS seems to be making into especially Kerala and Tamil Nadu is very worrying.
Right.
As you've already pointed out earlier in your show, Andhra Pradesh police have been seem to have been more successful perhaps in dealing with this or in perhaps stemming
Telangana
what could
police,
be called the increasing rot there. And it is, yes, sorry, Telangana now.
Yeah, sure, no,
it is increasingly worrying that in states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu, where traditionally there has not been this, what you call the polarization between communities, this is increasing. I don't think it is due to in as much the polarization of the Hindus, the majority community, as you're trying to say, but I think it's very difficult to actually analyze why, but it perhaps could be that the ISIS offers a different sort of appeal than what was offered earlier by Al-Qaeda, etc.
Okay.
There seems to be a more cerebral appeal that is being made by ISIS in terms of a more golden, way ahead, etc., etc., and a sacrifice for the larger good and that sort of things.
Right.
I don't know. I have never read ISIS material, but I hear this from some of my friends that it is now being couched not merely in as religious duty or fervor, but as more as a sort of service that is being done for their community.
Okay, let
and
me just
perhaps
go.
Perhaps that could be one of the reasons. I'm not sure, but this is what I hear.
Okay, Mohammad Saqib, I know you want to come in. I'll come back to you in a second, but Dulat Saab, you wanted to come in earlier.
Yeah, the point I wanted to make, Vasu, is that ISIS is, in whatever minuscule manner, is born not out of ideology, but more out of conflict, you know. Now, for instance, in Kashmir, we've been hearing for a long, long time that the presence of ISIS, but there is no ISIS. There's hardly any ISIS in Kashmir.
Yes.
There are some boys now who started thinking that way, like this fellow Musa who was killed recently.
Yes.
But the point is, just because black flags come out of anger and frustration, we can't say that, there is ISIS in Kashmir or that ISIS is growing in Kashmir. It won't grow in Kashmir because the Kashmiri Muslim thinks differently.
Right.
So it's not going to happen like that. That's why I said it's more logical in the South.
Yeah. Let me.
But my last point.
Okay.
My last point to you would be that please let's not exaggerate this.
Yes.
Because I think the media plays a big role in exaggerating all this.
No, that's why. That's why I said that's why right at the outset I said in sheer numbers, it's minuscule. But it does tend to get somewhat magnified.
Absolutely.
Yes,
absolutely.
Mohammad Saqib, you wanted to
come
in.
I hope you're not raising this because Rahul Gandhi got elected from Wayanad over there.
Oh my God, not at all. I didn't even think of that connection. Mohammad Saqib, yes.
Srini, in a pluralistic society like India, in a country like India, these ISIS or terrorist modules have very little scope. But unfortunately, the terror and the fear created by these Bajrang Dal elements, these BJP elements in the name of cow, in the name of temple, in the name of masjid, this will be a factor for these kind of terrorist elements to create some kind of ideological ground to fight the country. They will say
your country
is against you.
You're starting now a political debate and I'm running out of time.
Yeah, our country is not
you're
against.
You're starting a political debate and I'm told I have literally no time. But is it fair just to blame the Bajrang Dal and the BJP and Hindutva forces? As we mentioned, there are groups such as your own, like PFI itself, which is accused of stoking radical
sentiment. I am not saying they are not only reason. They are a factor.
Okay, you're saying they are a factor. Quick.
And this terrorist ideology is also a factor.
Okay, I need a quick response.
This though both
from
the
Lalita and then I have to wrap. Yes, Lalita Kumaramangalam, you want to quickly respond that how can you completely absolve Hindutva extremists of responsibility?
It's unfair to say the Bajrang Dal, etc.
Yeah.
No, no. I'm not saying in the South it's unfair to, you know, sort of dump this on Bajrang Dal or Gau Rakshaks, etc.
Yeah.
You've hardly heard of any incidents down there where the sort of where the sort of violence that happens in the North has happened. And
well, in Mangalore, on the Mangalore coast, quite a lot.
Maybe,
but otherwise,
policed,
elsewhere,
not sure,
perhaps not so much.
But there have been, yes, there have been a few isolated incidents, I agree.
Yeah.
But you can't blame them for this growth.
Okay.
This growth is very puzzling and quite worrying, actually.
Right.
It may be, as I'm told, a difference in the way they are approaching the Muslim, some members of the Muslim community.
Right.
I don't think it's fair to blame it on Hindus or Muslims, etc. I think it probably is that ISIS is doing a better job of marketing it, perhaps, if that's the way I could put it.
Okay.
It sounds very facile, but maybe that's one of it, because they are actually marketing themselves.
Okay. Well, we'll have to leave this part of our debate tonight here. Thank you very much indeed for joining us.